feel my creativity starting to flow, Walt! 'Cause you helped me become who I want to be.
Hello, and welcome back to the Game Master's Domain, where I take things from games and anime and adapt them into D&D 5th edition. Make sure to check out my Twitter and Patreon, by the way, if you want to help support me in the making of these homebrews. Right now, our goal is to reach 1,000 subscribers by the end of 2022. Also, if you haven't seen it already in our update video, we're looking for people to help kickstart a Discord server for the channel, to help early reviews of homebrews, and even suggest or submit your own content for review. If you are interested in that, go ahead and send us an email at gamemastersdomain@gmail.com with a little bit of information about yourself and your experience with D&D. If you have sent one in already and you haven't gotten a response, don't worry, we're just waiting on some more submissions first. And we will hopefully be able to get things started as we get closer to the end of the year. Today we have another subclass, and this time it's our first subclass for the most musically inclined class, the Bard. But instead of focusing on music, we'll be looking at a different form of art, painting, although this still doesn't need to be strictly painting-based either. This subclass is another of those that just kind of popped into my head, but so happened to have a few characters that fit well enough into it. And they gave me some solid ideas for actual abilities and how the subclass would play out. Those characters ended up being Koichi from JoJo, Sai from Naruto Shippuden, and more like Grisio from Honkai Impact. Now, with all that said, let's jump in and see what the College of the Brush has on their canvas. So, starting off, I wanted to make this a bit of a midfield support. That's just how bards normally play. Anyway, these bards are able to stay back a little bit further than normal, and still apply certain spells that would normally need to be cast with touch. They do this using their third level ability, the Living Brush, which you can summon as a bonus action, and it has the following properties. First, you are able to use it as a spellcasting focus for your bard spells. It also has a movement speed equal to your own, and you can move it on your turn without an action. It hovers just a few feet off the ground when not being held, however, it does need to stay within a 60-foot range of you, and if it leaves that range, it falls to the ground, losing its magic, until you resummon it as a bonus action. And lastly, you can cast your bard spells through the brush, as if they were originating from the brush itself. So for instance, if you had the Cure Wounds spell, and your brush was close to an ally, you could cast Cure Wounds on them through the brush while staying a bit back. This also works with the second feature you get at this level, Magical Pigments. These are special paints you create from your own supply of magic. There are 8 different pigments, one for each school of magic. In order to use these pigments, you first need to make sure you have access to it. That's as simple as just making sure you have a spell of matching type. So you can't use the Illusory pigment without knowing at least one illusion spell. Now, since there are 8 of these pigments, with 2 different effects depending on what you apply them to, I'm going to go through them rather quickly. Oh, and you do need to use a bard spell slot in order to use a pigment. First, we have Abjuration, the School of Protection. Putting this pigment on an object makes it stronger, able to take more of a beating. And putting it on a creature gives them some temporary HP. Our second pigment is Conjuration, the School of Summoning and Teleportation. If you paint this on an object, you can create a duplicate of that item in your hand. And putting it on a creature lets them use a bonus action to teleport themselves or something they're holding. Next up is Divination, the school for fortune tellers and spies alike. If you put this on an item, you can use that item to see and hear through it. And if you put it on a creature, you can share senses with each other. Fourth is Enchantment, for buffs, debuffs, and in between. This can let you make an item appear more valuable than it is, or give a creature advantage on charisma-based skill checks. After that, we get Evocation, and we all know Evocation is for damage. This one makes an item explode, whether you throw it or hit it with a weapon attack. It also gives creatures it's applied to extra damage on the weapon attacks for 1 minute. Okay, last two. Necromancy for healing and undead stuff. Two sides of the same coin, I suppose. This lets you make an object that attracts undead, or it lets you heal a creature based on the level of the spell slot you used for the pigment. And lastly for pigments is Transmutation, for changing things into other things. This lets you change 1 square foot of material on an object to another material, or lets you give a creature a +1 to their defenses for 1 hour. Whew, okay, that does it for those. Let's move on to the next feature at 6th level, one which I'm sure many aspiring artists have used to their advantage. And that is Artistic Freedom, which allows you to take a spell that you can see being cast within 160 feet of you, and learn that spell until you finish a long rest. You can also swap the damage type of the spell with another damage type of a spell you already know, if the one you're copying also does damage. You also gain a bonus to casting while using your brush as your spellcasting focus, and that being half of your proficiency bonus rounded down. With this, and the magical secrets that bards normally get, you're going to have a lot of spells at your disposal. Those combine with your magical pigments, and you should be prepared for anything. Now, bards are one of the classes that get some of their subclass abilities fairly early, and then you have to wait all the way until endgame to get any more. So your next feature after 6th level is all the way at 14th level. So after working your way through 8 more levels, you get the Mystic Brushstrokes feature, which lets you cast your bard spells from your brush and yourself at the same time, as long as it is a 5th level or lower, and a creature cannot be affected by more than one instance of a spell cast in this way. But your uses of this are limited based on your charisma modifier. This one took me a bit, but I wanted to keep the idea of casting through your brush and using both at the same time just seemed like the next natural step for the theme. Now we also have 2 spells to go over. One is a 1st level spell that lets you deal some damage, and the second is, well, we'll get to that one. It's a bit of a surprise. So starting off, our first spell is Chromatic Brush, a 1st level evocation spell with a range of self and a casting time of 1 bonus action. You can also maintain concentration on this spell for 1 minute. You make a melee spell attack as part of the casting, and on a hit it deals 2d6 damage. As for the damage type, you select that yourself based on one of the 2d6s you rolled. It can range from acid, cold, fire, lightning, poison, or thunder damage, each one matching to a number between 1 and 6. You can also remake this attack as a bonus action on your turn. For this, I wanted a bit of a mix between things like Chaos Bolt and Shadow Blade, but obviously not as strong since it's a 1st level spell. Our second and final spell for the day is a little different. This is based on a story titled Dorian Gray. I won't go too much into detail since that's not what this video is for, but long story short, it's about a man who paints a self-portrait that ages, among other things, for him. And the spell here is the Gray Canvas, a 6th level necromancy spell that takes 8 hours to cast and requires a couple things. First is a paintbrush and canvas worth 500 gold, which is consumed, and proficiency in painter's tools. For the casting time of 8 hours, you paint a self-portrait in great detail, and at the end of that 8 hours, the painting gains these traits. First, it has hit points equal to your own at the time of casting, its AC is 10 plus your casting modifier, it hovers 20 feet per round, and has resistance to non-magical damage. You can also choose to see through the painting's eyes as a bonus action. Also note, you have to be within 1 mile of the painting to use its primary effect, and if you move further than a mile away, it will move closer to you. Oh, and it also needs to be on the same plane of existence, so you can't just shove it into a bag of holding. Now the main effect of this spell is that as a reaction to taking damage, you can split the damage with the painting. However, if the painting ever reaches 0 HP, the spell ends and you take 6d10 necrotic damage, as well as 1d4 levels of exhaustion. Now you can touch up and repair the painting during a short or long rest by using spell slots, healing the painting 1d8 per spell slot level used. And with the spells complete, that brings us to our character building section. These go up to 5th level, and I'll be using the standard point array found in the player's handbook for stats. And for today, we'll be building Koichi from JoJo's Bizarre Adventures with his stand reverb. Koichi is a human, but he's also a stand user, so I'll go ahead and use that to make him a variant human and grab the Magic Initiate feat, letting him learn 2 wizard cantrips and 1 first level wizard spell. For his cantrips, we'll go with Create Bonfire to add a little bit of heat, and Message to quickly call for help if needed. And for his spell, we'll take Find Familiar, which right now is the best way for him to get reverb. Honestly, I would go with an owl, it can hold stuff in its talons, and it's good at staying safe with its flyby ability. As for his stats, we'll be putting his 15 into charisma, along with a +1 from his race. He's a kind kid and has made some friends with some fairly crazy people. Next is his wisdom at 14. He may not be very book smart, but he's still very quick and applies what he does know rather well. Constitution is going to be 13 with a +1 from his race for a total of 14. He survives with a hole in his neck for like half an episode. Even if he was saved in the end, that's still pretty tough for a kid. His dex is 12. He's pretty short and more acrobatic than he is athletic. Following that is strength at 10. He's, again, small, and he doesn't really punch his enemies out. Lastly, Koichi is going to dump intelligence. He may get better later on, but this boy is at risk for failing his classes, and still can't study even when his life does depend on it. For your background, build your own for proficiency in persuasion and deception. He's just a student after all, so nothing too complex. Moving on to his class, Koichi is a bard, meaning he gets a d8 hit die, proficiency in light armor and simple weapons, as well as a few other specific ones like rapiers or short swords. He also gets to pick between any 3 musical instruments. We've all been there when school tries to force you to learn the recorder at the very least, so I could see him knowing at least 1 instrument, if not a little bit of knowledge in 2 others. He's also proficient in charisma and dexterity saving throws, and gets to pick any 3 skills. We'll go with acrobatics, insight, and performance, leaving us with 5 skills at level 1. Wait, no, 6 skills level 1, since we also get to take investigation from being a variant human. Now at 1st level, bards get 2 features, The first is spellcasting, which uses their charisma modifier, and they get 2 cantrips from the bard list, as well as 4 first level spells, but they only get 2 spell slots to use them with. For cantrips, let's go with Minor Illusion for a little bit of trickery, and Thunderclap to keep the creepy stalker girl away. For now. Now, when it comes to spells, let's start off with Color Spray, letting you blind creatures in a 15-foot cone, Featherfall to make sure you and your friends have a soft landing, and Command, letting you say a single word command to a creature, or for Koichi, writing it on their bodies would suffice. And lastly, Dissonant Whispers, letting you pick out one creature and giving them a massive headache, blasting them with whatever sound you'd like them to hear. Outside of spells, you get Bardic Inspiration, which you can use to help your allies with ability checks, saving throws, or attack rolls. Just make sure they use it within 10 minutes or it goes to waste. Your rank doesn't stay on forever after all. Second level gives you Jack of All Trades, letting you add half of your proficiency bonus to all skill checks that you aren't already proficient in, and Song of Rest, which is just some extra healing during short rests, which could save your allies in some other hit die. Moving on to third level, Koichi is a College of the Brush Bard, letting him summon a magical paintbrush as a bonus action, and with that, Reverb is born. Hand your brush to your owl, or just flavor your brush to look like Reverb, and now you have a flying companion with a brush to cast your spell through. You also get magical pigments, but I'm not going to list them all again, but by this point you should have a good few of them aside from necromancy. Well, that is until now when you get second level spells, and for this we'll be taking blindness and deafness, letting you block off one of those 2 sights for an enemy. At fourth level, bump charisma up to 18 for better saving throws, spell attacks, and also more inspiration die. At fifth level, we get to add on to that with Font of Inspiration, letting you regain inspiration die after a short rest, so you won't feel the need to hold onto them quite so tightly. You also get 3rd level spells at this level, and for now we'll go with Dispel Magic, a very useful spell to have in general, and will help get rid of any pesky traps set up by enemy stands. And that ends the character building section. It was a bit rough for me to pick who I wanted to make in the first place, as at first I was going to make Sai, but the Bard spell list really isn't conducive to his fighting style. If you like this sort of content, check out my other videos for races, subclasses, and monsters, and if you have any feedback, feel free to leave them in the comments below. That will do it for our session today though. I'll see you next week, and have a wonderful day.